Welcome to Millennial 611. I'm Andrew.
I'm Laura.
And I'm Pamela.
So y'all, we are down to 7 rolls of toilet paper.
Oh my god, Laura, I didn't know it was so bad.
Yeah, in the T. Laz household.
And I'm so sorry.
I'm kind of concerned because I was thinking, oh, maybe I can go online and buy toilet paper somewhere, like have it shipped to our house. Except everywhere is sold out, even online. I went to Target and it showed that they had one available. They had one in stock and I was like, fuck yeah, I got this shit. And so I grabbed it. And when I went to put it in my cart, I got a notification that was like, oh, sorry, it's out of stock.
Uh-oh, and I was that was like, me. I beat you to it.
I was like, oh, fuck. I can't even get the shitty, like, single-ply toilet paper. Like, there's nothing.
You might have to start raiding the public restrooms.
I'm scared. I'm scared we're going to have to resort to paper towels.
Or order that bidet and hope that it's considered an essential item on Amazon. Well,
and that's
where's
the thing.
Bidet?
So bidets are backed up until May. I was looking.
Are you kidding?
Oh, yeah.
At all the producers, and they're like, "Yeah, we'll have them back at the end of May." Because of course, people are panic buying those right now too. So
Amazon is a disaster right now. If you look for anything related to the pandemic or not, you will not get it at the normal speed that you're accustomed to. Like Pam just alluded to, Amazon is prioritizing essential items right now being shipped first. And so, but even those essential items are all out of stock, so you can't even get them anytime soon. I looked for fun at Animal Crossing, a physical copy, a brand new Nintendo game, to see how long it would take. It said Friday. Today's Monday. That's longer than usual. They are really backed up, and I'm sure they have plenty of those available, and we'll talk about Animal Crossing at the end of today's show.
So Tara in our Discord is saying, a restaurant in my neighborhood is selling toilet paper by the roll on Uber Eats.
That's a good idea.
This is how we die. Like, this is it.
If they were really smart, they would have a promo, like, order $30 worth of food and we'll throw in a roll of toilet paper.
Seriously. Mm-hmm.
Well, I'm really proud of my theory that I brought up last week, that people just don't know how much toilet paper they actually use. So they're just buying a ton just to be safe. And I think somebody heard my theory because now there's a tool online where you can calculate how much longer the TP that you have on hand will last in your household. And we'll take that test later in today's episode. And of course, we will talk about the effects of the coronavirus again today because it really just is life right now. We're all just dealing with the stress, the anxiety. What are the biggest changes in our day-to-day lives right now? Since I last podcasted, Chicago is now under a shelter in place. This took effect on Saturday evening. And the thing that I brought up a few weeks ago that I said I didn't want to lose access to was the gym. So I ran to the gym on Saturday one last time. And of course, there was like 25 other people there, which is not common for that gym. It's a smaller neighborhood gym. So I probably got coronavirus that day. But I had to because it's the last time for like 2-3 weeks that I'm going to be going. And now I'm going to be rocking this fit desk behind me. I was on that for 90 minutes earlier today.
Yeah, it was funny. I actually called Andrew for some technical help in the middle of the day. And he picks up the Zoom and he's like, okay, just so you know, I'm on the fit desk right now. And I was like, okay, Andrew, like, if you want to pant while you talk to me, that's fine, boo. You do you.
I said, I'm either on the fit desk or getting fucked by Pat. You can decide which one it is. That is a do not social, Jewel. That is a do not social.
Oh, yeah.
My parents will see that clip.
It's too late. It's probably already on its way to Instagram.
But yeah, so losing the gym, that was a bummer to me. But Pat's home, and it's been nice having him work from home. He's working in the second bedroom, so I kind of forget that he's here. But then we, you know, get together a few times throughout the day, just like check in with each other, and it's nice. And he brought me Dunkin' in bed. That's on sweet. Friday morning. So yeah, good times.
I think the biggest change for us is just having to be really intentional when we think about what needs to be a trip, like what is a necessary trip out. Like if I want ice cream, for example, like does that necessitate going out and potentially exposing myself and others? Probably not. So it's like thinking about, okay, let's try and group things into large grocery trips so that we're not making a whole bunch of like standalone trips out into the world. Yeah. So our grocery trips have been like more need-based, whereas I think before all of this, they were want-based.
I think I agree with Laura that it's less of a want and more of a do we really need to go out? So like I cook at dinner every night for me and whoever else is home. And so now instead of thinking to myself, oh, I'm just going to read a couple recipe blogs and see if I can get inspired to try something new, it's more like, let me just cook with what I have in my pantry instead of having to go out and buy, you know, three different things to add to whatever I'm making. But also, Andrew and I have talked before about how we like to get out of the house to work as a little bit of a treat. And it is really sad to lose that. It's not a huge deal in the grand scheme of things at all, but
right.
it does kind of feel weird not to be able to say, you know what, like you should go treat yourself. You worked really hard. So why don't you go and get, you know, this part of your day done at Starbucks or at some other coffee shop?
Well, and Starbucks is straight up closed nationwide. Yeah. I was very surprised when they did that. They said they're going to have a few open that are like inside hospitals and areas where people really need coffee, the first responders. If Dunkin' closes, I'm going to be super upset. Like Starbucks, I like it, but I don't love it. Dunkin', it's a part of me. So if Dunkin' breaks away from me, I will actually cry. Not even joking.
Do we know what Starbucks is doing for its hourly employees?
I think paying them. I think they are still paid.
Okay, that's good.
We can look into that. Don't quote me on that, though.
I mean, it is, you know, a scary time for hourly workers. My brother is a bartender, and both of the bars that he works at are closed now.
Mm-hmm.
So
mm-hmm.
he's kind of at the mercy of those government checks, which we'll talk about a little later in the show.
I have been trying to still support local because, to that point about the bars, bars and restaurants are really suffering right now, and they still have to pay rent, you know, and some of them are still trying to pay their employees. So I've been trying to get takeout from a couple of places, including a local bagel shop that I really like. I've been there the past two weekends in a row, and I have a hard time following the staying six feet apart from other people rule. Have you guys been trying to deal with that? Like, it just, yeah. it kind of feels ridiculous to actually do in practice. Like, you're seeing everybody stand so far away from each other, and you're like, this is weird.
Honestly, I have a problem with people not doing that. So it's the other way around. Like, I don't think, but in general, I don't know. I just don't want you to stand very close to me if I don't know you anyway. So I don't know.
In practice anyway.
Yeah, yeah.
I think that most people don't understand what, like, how much 6 feet is.
It's far. Yeah,
oh, it is 100%. I was so upset with my aunt the other day because she's really big on Facebook. She's big into Facebook, and she posted a picture of herself standing in line at Costco. You know, like everybody else, she was going to get prepared. And then I overheard her talking with my mom on the phone saying she had been there. And I said, hey, mom, ask her how far away she was standing. And she goes, I was standing, you know, an arm's length away. And then I like turned my phone around. I was like, does this look arm's length away? No, because they were literally like so close together. Everybody in that line was so close together. And I just thought to myself, like, how this is so stupid. You know, you just shouldn't do that to yourself right now. At least. Yeah. Put a little bit of distance between yourself and the other person.
I will say, and I don't know if this is happening for y'all, but the last time I was at the grocery store, there were a number of customers in there wearing masks and gloves as they grocery shopped. And I was like, did y'all not hear that that doesn't do anything?
But you know what? I was thinking about this. Yeah, I've been seeing this too. I feel like people are just thinking, well, it's better than nothing. It must be better than nothing.
Yeah, you know, it would be better than that, allowing, you know, medical workers to have access to that equipment that there's already a shortage for.
Pam, you mentioned Costco. I was cracking up at Costco a few days ago because they were spraying each cart's handlebars down with like this big gun that would spit out hand sanitizer. She was doing such a shitty job. Like, you take your cart, you walk past this woman, and she tries to spray down the handlebar, but it wasn't getting on it. So I was like, what is the point of this? And you're holding this, like, it looks like a weed killer machine where you got the big jug and then you got the nozzle. It was ridiculous. And then Trader Joe's was like offering hand sanitizer, spraying it onto your hands when you walked in and out. It's
my Target was doing that too.
Oh, really?
When I went last week, yeah. That was literally somebody's job, just to stand there with a big bucket of hand sanitizer and squirt yeah. away.
I will say, I think I maintain that Publix is the best grocery store that I've ever had an experience in. Walking in there, they have a tall, like waist height Purell sanitizer rag dispenser. Where you reach mm-hmm. over, you grab a disposable rag that is soaked in Purell, you wipe down the cart to your satisfaction, and there is a trash can right there. And next nice. To that, there is a hand sanitizer dispenser so that after you've sanitized the cart, you can then sanitize your hands and go about your shopping in peace.
Honestly, wow. That sounds like a dream.
Publix is a dream.
Speaking of wipes, did you guys hear America's septic systems have been getting backed up like crazy because everybody's using these wipes and flushing them?
I can't believe it's not common knowledge that you're not supposed to flush that stuff.
Wipes are terrible for our yep. septic systems, y'all. Do not flush them down there. Or condoms,
or
tampons
sanitary
too, right?
Pads, nap, all that stuff.
So a couple of show business items. First of all, just want to mention that the three of us did a digital coffee break. I think we were talking about doing this during After Dark last week. So we did that last week. It was a lot of fun. We were just hanging out and answering people's questions. We'll probably do more of those in the future. Speaking of another hangout like that, we will be doing a Bay hangout for Bay level patrons Tuesday night, tonight, March 24th. So if you are a Bay, please tune in for that. And everybody will be able to hang out and talk back. Everybody's invited into a group video chat, unlike the digital coffee date where it's just us three.
Yeah. And the digital coffee dates are actually open to everyone. So if you're,
yes.
if you are a patron, if you aren't a patron, everybody is welcome. And we're advertising them heavily on social. So keep an eye out and we would love to see you for the next one.
Yeah.
Speaking of Patreon, we wanted to give a shout out to our latest patrons. They are Kathy, Savannah, Akalia, Alyssa, Janet, Kiana, Desta, Selena, Marissa, Katrin, Alexis, Enith, Elsa, Bailey, Leah, Kara, Sydney, Dayasha, Parker, Sarah, Lily, Claire, and Scott. Thank you so much for your support. It really means a lot to us right now in particular. Every dollar does make a difference and allows us to keep this show on the air.
Yeah.
Glad to have you.
Yeah. So welcome. We have had a bunch more people join recently. It's been really nice to see. Hopefully everybody's enjoying the bonus content. I'm showing some chest tonight. I'm expecting another bump in patrons now that I've just mentioned that.
I showered before the show.
So. Oh, thank you.
You're welcome.
You do smell nice and clean.
Thank you. That's mm-hmm. another feature that we've added. You can smell us through the Patreon.
Smell-o-vision. This week's episode is sponsored by HoneyBook, a company for small business owners that helps take some stress out of your life, something that'd be super helpful right now. If you're a small business owner, you got into your line of work because of your passion. But if tedious administrative work is keeping you from doing the part of your job that you actually love, HoneyBook can take those tasks off your to-do list so you can focus on why you started your business in the first place. HoneyBook is an online business management tool that organizes your client communications, bookings, contracts, and invoices all in one place. It's perfect for freelancers, entrepreneurs, or small business owners that want to consolidate services they already use, like QuickBooks, Google Suite, Excel, and MailChimp. With HoneyBook, you can automate your busy work. They have easy-to-use templates for emails, proposals, brochures, and invoices. They also have e-signatures and built-in automation to save you time and get you paid faster. Simplify your to-do list and stay in control with HoneyBook. Right now, HoneyBook is offering our listeners 50% off when you visit tryhoneybook.com/MILL. Payment is flexible, and this promotion applies whether you pay monthly or annually. Go to tryhoneybook.com/MILL for 50% off your first year. I love that we have many small business owners out there, and I know that you will love to take some stress out of your day with the tools provided by HoneyBook. So give it a try. So we wanted to talk more about coronavirus in terms of what you may have missed and what you need to know, because there's some things that have developed over the past week that are really important for our listeners to know, especially those of you who are millennials. But Laura, you noticed something with credit cards recently, right?
Yeah. So not just right now, but during, I mean, all the time you should be vigilant about your credit cards, but particularly during crises like the one that we're in right now, the bad guys will take advantage of the fact that we're all very distracted by what's going on with the coronavirus to take that opportunity to commit credit card fraud. So today I actually noticed, I was checking my card statement, that I had a new subscription that I was signed up for, Audible. I do not, I do not have an Audible subscription because Mark has an Audible subscription. So I wasn't going to make one of my own. And I call and I'm like, okay, maybe like the payment method got mixed up and somehow he, like his subscription got billed to me. I call the credit card company and they actually, their automated robot on the phone is like, we can see that this purchase was made on this day at 1:30 in the morning and that your card details were entered manually. So like somebody typed that shit in. And I call the credit card company and I'm like, nope, this was not me. And they went through a few verification details with me and ended up declaring it fraud, canceled the card. And now they're sending me a new one. So just keep really close attention to your card statements right now, guys, because you know, it's so many places have been hacked and it's very possible that our card details are out floating around somewhere on the web. So just being sure that you're aware of like what subscriptions are genuine, what to expect coming through on your bills, because the last thing that we want right now is to become the victims of fraud during a time when finances are, you know, more important than ever.
I signed up for Audible recently. And when you said that, I was like, did I accidentally
use my card?
Laura's credit card?
Do you have my credit card? Do we have a joint account?
Yeah. So one of the things I wanted to point out is that younger adults are actually a large percentage of coronavirus hospitalizations in the United States. And the reason we bring this up is because early on in the coronavirus pandemic, we had spoken about, and a lot of people had spoken about, that this had been primarily affecting older populations. And while that is true, a CDC analysis of U.S. cases from February 12th to March 16th released Wednesday shows 38% of those sick enough to be hospitalized were younger than 55. And I've been spending too much time on Twitter recently, and I've seen these stories of millennials being hospitalized as well. Don't think that you're immune to this because you could very well get it and become hospitalized potentially.
Yeah. And I mean, even, you know, I think it's easy from the outside looking in to say, oh, I'm young and healthy, so I don't think coronavirus could kill me or would kill me. And it might not, but the symptoms are really severe. You know, doctors are saying that as much as 80% of the people who contract coronavirus experience mild symptoms, but the remaining 20% have really severe issues, like down to breathing issues. People are having to be hooked up to respirators. And that's why we're in the middle of this crisis, because there aren't enough respirators to account for the number of people who need them. Right. So just bear that in mind when you're thinking about what trips out into the world are absolutely necessary for me.
And I hope getting the word out about that will kind of, you know, make those people that are, you know, on that whole, oh, if I get it, I get it, I'm young, I'll be fine train. I really hope it wakes them up, because why would you want to risk the possibility of your case being severe enough to, you know, really cause some potentially permanent damage?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, it kind of freaks me out because I have asthma, as we established before we started this episode. And, you know, that just makes me more susceptible to respiratory illnesses. So I'm trying very hard to minimize exposure for sure.
Meanwhile, the Senate is trying to put together a stimulus package, and they've the Dems and the Republicans have been in disagreement. We thought this was going to go smoother. It looked like it was going to be that way over the weekend. But now there's some fighting and we don't know when this is going to happen. But one of the big ideas that is probably going to happen is that Americans are going to be getting one, probably two checks, one in April and then one, I guess, at some point over the summer, $1,000 or so, depending on how much you make. And they're fighting over the details over that. And actually, not just that. Republicans are trying to give big corporations a bailout and not have to agree to certain terms. And the Dems are like, well, they could just take that money and run. You need to make sure that they aren't going to go and fire people after we try to save them.
Yeah, and it's a substantial amount. I mean, we're talking $500 billion for the government to give out loans to companies to use with very little oversight. And due to that lack of oversight, it makes it highly likely that those funds would not make their way to the workers, which is ultimately what the Democrats are pushing back against. And apparently House Democrats have been working on a bill, like a rebuttal bill. I saw it on NPR today. So it really remains to be seen what's going to happen. I'm kind of a mind that I understand why there's this opposition to a slush fund. That's what it's being called, because it would sort of allow companies to be lent money, as I mentioned, with like very few restrictions or requirements. But at the same time, if you're up on politics, and if you're reading this, and if you're privileged enough to like have access to the level of education that you would need, and also like technology or even access to a newspaper, these are nuances that you can understand. But if you're just Joe Schmo, whose rent is due on April 1st, and all mm-hmm. you're seeing is that Congress could be giving you a $1,000 check, but they're not, because they're disagreeing about something that you don't think has any impact on you, i.e. money for large businesses, this could backfire on the Democrats. And that's what's concerning to me. Yeah. I understand the pushback against it, but there's part of me that's like, I don't know if this is the hill to die on, you know?
Yeah. Well, and meanwhile, we were just talking about this and hashing it out. Trump is already pushing for this idea to reduce the number of restrictions across the country. He wants people working again. He wants people out and about again because the economy is tanking. But it's way too soon. The cases here have surged. I mean, there's been 30,000 in New York City alone. There's 50, 60,000 across America now. The number's going up every day. 500 people have now died in this country. Just 100 new deaths reported in the past 24 hours. So it is not the time to be talking about, hey, everybody go out again. Everything's cool. That's really dangerous because a lot of people are still carrying it and don't know it, A. B, a lot of people have already been resisting these calls to stay indoors. We see them down at the beach, out in the parks, and they're bragging about it on social media. Oh, it's the, you know, coronavirus ain't gonna get me. I'm invisible.
And what's concerning about that is you had just last week, like Vice President Mike Pence saying that this could very well go into July and August. So it's such mixed messaging from the White House. And it's no wonder people aren't taking it seriously.
Yeah. Oh, July or August. Oh, my gosh. We won't be talking about this every week between now and July or August. God, I promise you all that. Good news for you, Laura. A few weeks ago, you were saying you were resisting paying your taxes and filing your tax return. Well, the deadline has been extended to mid-July, so you can continue to procrastinate.
Perfect. July 14th, I'll be here.
If this goes through July or August, they might push it again. How about we just don't pay taxes this year?
I would be down with that. That would actually seem fair, to be perfectly honest with you. I'm like, America has failed this year. I don't think we should have to pay for it.
Yeah, America failed us. What am I paying you for, America? Yeah.
Can I return this? Speaking of financial assistance, there's been some movement on the student loans front. So the Trump administration announced that they're freezing interest on student loans for at least the next 60 days. Basically, what that means is that your federally held student loans will not accrue any interest moving forward until they reinstate the interest. Mm-hmm. For people like me who have a shit ton of student loan debt, it kind of doesn't make a difference because I still have to pay my loans every month and there's still a fuck ton of interest that has already accrued on it. But if you have smaller loan balances, this could be a nice break for you. Also, a lot of the loan holders out there are advertising that they're advertising an extended forbearance program that's specific to COVID-19. So if you experience any kind of loss of income, you should be able to call your loan servicer and let them know about that and see what options they can provide you to not have to pay those loans for at least 60 days is what I read on FedLoan. So definitely worth reaching out to your loan servicer to see what options there are.
So yeah, this week there's going to be this debate over, well, should we start sending Americans back out onto the streets or should we continue encouraging everybody to stay indoors? And I hope it is the latter, because if Trump gets his wish and people start going back outside, this thing is probably going to flare up again.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, it doesn't seem to be, you know, sort of like flu season, for example, which tends to die down as it gets warmer. I mean, this is a worldwide phenomenon. And if it were something that could be quelled by warm climates, it wouldn't be a global problem.
Right. Yeah.
So that's my concern.
Well, and just look at California. I mean, the weather there has been warm. They still had a massive outbreak.
Oh, my God. Yeah. So nice, in fact, that even though the whole state is under a shelter in place, people thought that they could still go to the beach or like travel to the beach. And so as a result, Marin County, which is where I grew up, they actually had to make the decision to close all of their parks and beaches because people, you know, we can't have nice things if people don't adhere to the idea of social distancing. So please just, you know, do yourselves a favor. And so you guys can have nice things in your community and just kind of stick to staying local when you go outside, if you're also in shelter in place like we are.
And keep 6 feet, even though it's weird to do so.
Yeah. Don't make friends with people at the beach. Just like be the most antisocial.
Maybe Pam, we can get like shock collars that we all wear. And anytime you come within 6 feet of somebody. If we get too close.
That sounds like a YA dystopian romance novel waiting to happen.
It does. Suzanne Collins, no, get on it.
Yeah.
So there's this site, howmuchtoiletpaper.com, and it will help you compute how much toilet paper you need to survive the pandemic and how much your existing supply, how much longer it will last. So we all entered our data into this calculator, and it asks questions like the number of rolls that you have, toilet visits per day, average number of wipes per trip, sheets per wipe, sheets on roll, people in household, days of quarantine, everything. Anyway, I'm very proud to say, 20 rolls that I purchased way before this pandemic happened. And my supply will last 80 days, according to the tool. Don't get too jealous, y'all.
I have 7 rolls.
Godspeed.
We have 19 days. According to the tool.
Tick.
Yeah. Tick. Oh, man. Andrew, if we get really desperate, I may ask you to overnight me some toilet paper.
Oh, my God. I should, just for the hell of it.
Oh, my God. Yeah, see how much that'll cost.
What if someone steals it?
Like, yeah.
When I was looking to have toilet paper delivered, I was like, what if it's delivered to my dorm? One of my neighbors takes it. Like, I never would have thought of that.
So we had, my brother he goes to school in Portland and he was having trouble finding some things. So last night I was packing a box because I managed to find some disinfectant wipes for him when I was out at the store. And as I was wrapping it, I thought to myself, I wonder if somebody's going to steal this.
We got to get guns. Time to get a weapon.
Yeah, those shops are popping, even though I don't think they're technically essential businesses.
Oh, they're essential. My right to a gun is essential.
Yeah. South of the Mason-Dixon line, they are essential. What do they think they're going to do? Shoot the coronavirus?
One of my friends went and bought more ammo for his gun. And I said, you're insane, because he thinks there's going to be this uprising and you're going to have to fend for yourselves out there, not over toilet paper.
It's
but
not the zombie apocalypse.
The Walking Dead has ruined a lot of people's perception of what would actually happen in an apocalypse, I think, because they think it's going to be something like that.
Just wait it out until all the dumb people kill themselves or kill each other, right?
Right,
and
yeah.
Then you can go out and raid their guns, honestly.
And bathroom closets.
Right.
So later in today's episode, we're going to talk about technology helping with anxiety, because it's become a real problem, especially lately. And we hope everybody's doing okay, and we hope these suggestions for apps and what to avoid will help. But Pam, you also have a topic that's completely unrelated to coronavirus. Oh my goodness, thank you.
Yeah, I tried my best, y'all. And we were going to do this segment last week, but it's kind of evergreen because I don't see it stopping. So we're just going to talk about it now. This was inspired by Sarah Palin, her recent stint on Fox's The Masked Singer. So this show is kind of like everywhere right now. It's huge. I'm sure you guys have heard about it. It's a singing competition. But the gimmick is that it's all celebrities that are singing, and you don't know who they are until they take off these outlandish costumes that they put them in. And so Sarah Palin was on the show, and she performed Baby Got Back twice, once when she was still masked and once when they unmasked her. So
This happened the night that something else happened in relation to coronavirus.
It was right before... Like, this happened, oh my God, I feel like the days have just blurred together, but this was right before Trump's big addressing of the nation in terms of the coronavirus. Yeah.
So this was the same night that the NBA shut down and that Tom Hanks announced that he had coronavirus.
Yeah,
and then
exactly.
This shit happens on Fox.
And our big prize was Sarah Palin performing Sir Mix-a-Lot's big hit.
Oh my God, what is our show?
Laura's face just said it all.
But that's the thrill of The Masked Singer, because you never know who you're going to get, right? I haven't watched the show, but people love it.
It can be really fun, I will say. But the best part is that they have this, like, they have this panel, right, of other, like, famous people. And Robin Thicke of Blurred Lines fame, he incorrectly guessed that it was Tina Fey under the mask, which I thought was a little too on the nose.
Yeah, I wonder how that makes her feel.
Anyway, I wanted to bring this up because while Sarah Palin is the most recent politician to make headlines for her stint on a reality competition series, she's definitely not the only person that's ever done this. Very, very recently, we saw Sean Spicer on Dancing with the Stars. And before this, Rick Perry, who was also a presidential candidate hopeful, also competed on Dancing with the Stars. And before that, former Texas House Representative Tom DeLay also competed on Dancing with the Stars. And then over on Big Brother, Omarosa, who I kind of give her a little bit of a pass because she did start off in reality television, but she recently also was a political aide for Trump and a former director of communications for the Office of Public Liaisons under his administration. She was on the first season of Celebrity Big Brother, and then Anthony Scaramucci was also on Celebrity Big Brother right after her. So,
but Omarosa found her fame through The Apprentice, the Donald Trump reality show. And then Donald Trump hires her in his administration because liked her from The Apprentice and Black. That's it. That was the reason.
So she gets a little pass, but I felt like it was important to include her just because she was, you know, she's now dabbled in politics and she was a recent addition. And, you know, they put her in there because they wanted her to give the dirt on Trump. But
she
stayed pretty tight-lipped. So,
well, and then Sean Spicer, who you mentioned, so he was the former White House press secretary, goes to Dancing with the Stars, makes a fool out of himself on that show. He was just in the White House briefing room a couple days ago, representing one of the networks. Nobody knew he was going to be there. They just cut to him, and there's Sean asking a question as a member of the press. Dude, you were just on Dancing with the Stars, and now you're in the White House again? What the fuck?
Well, it's like, it's the same thing with Rick Perry. Like, he went on Dancing with the Stars after he, you know, tried running for president, after he served as the Texas state governor. But then he went back and he was also appointed to a role under Trump's administration. He was the U.S. Secretary of Energy for a hot minute, just like everybody else in Donald Trump's cabinet. So, you know, it's not uncommon to see these people. They like take a break from politics, try and kind of almost clean up their image in a way by doing something fun and silly so that we'll all forget. I don't know. That's kind of like my interpretation of it.
Yeah,
and
then it's it humanizes
like
them.
Often that they go back and, you know, do other roles, like it maybe not the same roles, but they're still kind of, you know, in politics.
It humanizes them and they need to continue making money. After their roles in politics, they just don't have anything else. I guess you get the occasional speaking gig, but people like this who were made out to be jokes, Rick Perry and Sean Spicer and Omarosa, nobody really wants them to speak at their events because they're jokes. So they have to go and do these things where they're really desperate for stars, like Dancing with the Stars. I mean, so many of those people are F-list celebrities.
Yeah.
Like they would hire one of us to be on Dancing with the Stars. They're so desperate.
No, I mean, I remember because, okay, I'm about to confess something. I've never like been a huge fan of Dancing with the Stars, but I absolutely kept up with it the season that Bindi Irwin was on.
Yeah, but Bindi? Why wouldn't you? She also made the world cry.
She's just great.
Yeah, she's
great. Just wonderful and just like magically good at everything. Like, okay. But yeah, I think it was that season or a different one. They had like a Vine star on, like some kid who was famous for 5 minutes because of his fucking Vine. So yeah, they would take us. We could apply. I would not. I am not coordinated. But
no, you would have to. You could document it on this podcast, the experience with the show. And
I would
probably
do
make
it
like 25
like
grand an episode.
A free personal trainer, you know? Like,
that's
look at all
true.
Those people that lose a shitload of weight because they're dancing all day long.
Yeah,
and then maybe you can hop on one of those convention circuits. Like, you can attend
all
the Wizard
more money.
World.
Perfect. Right. Dancing with the Stars can pay off our student loans.
And then you can go on Cameo. Go.
See, and then if I do that, Pam, I don't have to donate my eggs in order to pay off my student
exactly.
loans. So, there's that. I'm just kidding. But I do want to give some credit to, I forget his name, the host of Dancing with the Stars.
Tom Irwin?
Yeah,
Bergeron.
Yeah. But when Sean Spicer was announced for Dancing with the Stars, he very like strongly and publicly opposed that, saying that the show was normalizing somebody who was, you know, a part of the destruction of American democracy. Mm-hmm. So I have to give him some credit for that.
And that's really the danger here, isn't it? That, you know, somebody like a Sean Spicer who delivered a huge blow to the credibility of the media is now able to, you know, make over his image and then he can go back and still be a public servant.
Yep. He can wear lime green and do a really shitty samba and then everybody's like, oh, look, he's so relatable.
Yeah. Then he's just the nice guy. And they conveniently paired him with, you know, a really young professional. So it's like, oh, look, he's hip with the young kids because she didn't care. And they had a nice, cute relationship on TV. So trust
him. Never forget, at the very first White House briefing, Sean Spicer goes up there and says, President Trump's inauguration was the biggest inauguration ever. Period. He went out there all angry because Trump was mad that people were saying nobody attended his inauguration, which was true if you looked at the photos. Then Sean Spicer takes the White House briefing room podium and lies to the American people on day one, just so blatantly. F that guy. And that's why Tom was mad when he got invited onto Dancing with the Stars. I would be too.
We also pulled you guys over in the Facebook group because I just wanted to know what, you know, the general public thought about this because we're just three people. So most of you, I think, aligned with how we feel, which is that you don't really care for the trend, even though it's probably here to stay. And then the second highest poll option was I'm indifferent. So 33 people voted for that and only 2 people voted for I'm all for it. So
I'm surprised that so many people don't like it. You think about who these television shows appeal to. Is it just like middle America? They get tickled by this type of thing.
I was thinking about that too. And I think that you're right. Middle America, they are definitely the demographic that they're aiming for with these shows. Mm-hmm. And you can see that still happening based on who wins, you know, because like something like Dancing with the Stars and also American Idol, like it's usually the same kind of contestant that always takes home the top prize. Mm-hmm. On American Idol, country stars very notoriously win because they're safe. And that's what middle America likes, even if you have somebody that might appeal more to maybe what like the coasts would deem more radio friendly. So it is interesting. And that's probably why they're going to keep doing it. But also because like all press is good mm-hmm. press.
You know what cracks me up about The Voice and American Idol? There has not been a breakout star on either of those shows for so long. The Voice has never had a major star, like a Kelly Clarkson, like American Idol produced. Voice hasn't had shit, but American Idol hasn't had anything in years, a big person in years. And this show runs every year. It mm-hmm. left Fox. It ended. Yeah. Then it came back like 6 months later on ABC with season one. Ryan Seacrest still there.
I will say that I think that the Voice, the only people that have found marginal niche success are the people that decided to go into country music or really wanted to go into country music after working with Blake Shelton because he has all the ins. But that again, that can be such a niche audience, even though there are so many country music fans. But you kind of like take that path knowing that you're probably not going to get mainstream radio play.
Right.
Anyway, that's all I had to say about that. I just thought it was interesting and it's probably going to keep happening. And it was a good time to talk about it because Sarah Palin just did Masked Singer. So I'm sure we'll see more politicians coming down the pipeline on there and on other shows soon.
Will Donald Trump?
Whenever we get rid of Trump, this will be his first stop. Maybe not Dancing with the Stars.
Oh my God. I was going to say, can you imagine Donald Trump on Dancing with the Stars?
It's like a little too much exertion for him. I don't think they would let him eat a diet of Big Macs while he was doing that. So but he will.
Or who else in the administration would do that? Pence wouldn't.
I feel like he'd send Ivanka to do it.
Pence is too puritanical.
Kellyanne Conway would 100% go on Big Brother.
Kellyanne would do it. And then George would like sit on the sidelines and like hate tweet about her.
Yeah. Why did my wife go on Big Brother? I can't believe it. Oh, you're making good money? Never mind.
It's hard to think of who else would go because he's just got this like constant revolving door of cabinet members.
Right.
Maybe Betsy DeVoe.
Oh, yeah. Or Ben Carson. He would.
Ben Carson would for sure. Yep. All right. Well, it's time for a quick break to hear from one of our other sponsors, Bombas. Did you know that socks are the number one most requested clothing item in homeless shelters? Well, Bombas is on a mission to change that. They've created the most comfortable socks in the history of feet. And for every pair of socks purchased, Bombas donates a pair to someone in need, which is more important now than ever. They're made from super soft, natural cotton, and every pair comes with arch support, a seamless toe, and a cushioned footbed that's comfy but not too thick. I got several pairs of their cotton socks and one pair of their merino wool socks, and these are honestly really cozy. I wear them to work, the gym, just to hang around the house. Nowadays, it's mostly hanging around the house. And what I love about them is they keep my feet warm in the cooler months, but they're really breathable so my feet don't get too hot when it's warm out. They also have great colors and patterns that go with pretty much anything. Save 20% on your first purchase when you shop at bombas.com/MILL. That's bombas.com, bombas.com/MILL to save 20%. Head on over to bombas.com/MILL to get your new bomb ass socks today.
I'm wearing my bomb ass Bombas right now. I love them.
Why are you Southern? Are you
I don't
still?
Know. It's just easier to speak that way. It's more fun. That's why I do it like half the show.
Yeah, it's more folksy and relatable.
Yeah.
Well, moving on to talk about something that is not necessarily Corona-centric, but I guess it's like Corona-adjacent, and yes. That is dealing with anxiety during these times. And something that we've talked about on the show a lot before is how technology can really exacerbate anxiety and make it worse because we're in this constantly connected society where we've got to have it now and we're getting notifications all the time and we're used to two-day shipping from Amazon Prime. So it seems like now, more than any time, is a great time for people to learn about the tech options that are out there that it can actually help manage and reduce anxiety, since we're spending so much time inside.
Yeah.
So Vox actually had a really great article about this, but there are several apps that are out there that can help with this. Some of them take the form of like AIs that will help guide you through mindfulness activities. Some of them are like games. And I thought that we could talk about some of the stuff that we've tried, and also make a couple of recommendations based on apps who have good deals going on right now. Mm-hmm. But first, what kind of technology do we find really stressful? Like, if you had to pick a top one thing about tech that really stresses y'all out, what would it be?
Just being inundated with news in the Trump administration. So that would be through Twitter primarily for me. And I think I've said this before, I have unfollowed a lot of news accounts since he took office because I don't need to read the same horrific headline 15 times a day. Just the news, that's what stresses me out most of all. So I try to limit my time on Twitter and the sources that I'm seeing on Twitter.
Yeah, I have to echo that. Also, I'm a big news junkie, so it's no surprise that I have several different news apps on my phone, which means that anytime this dumbass does something, I'm literally getting BBC, Vox, New York Times, Washington Post, like all of them giving me the same fucking notification. Yeah. And it all goes off at the same time. It's awful.
Won't you turn that off?
I have.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. But
yeah, because
that was what started happening when he got elected.
So the only news source that I have been getting push notifications from has been the New York Times. I love the New York Times app. Mm-hmm. Recently, I've had the Washington Post app for a while, but recently I tried to turn on notifications, and to turn on any of the subcategories in the notifications, like tech news, world news, you have to also have on the breaking news notification.
You don't need to know that Rand Paul has coronavirus 15 times.
Yeah, yeah. Once is more than enough.
I've turned off all push notifications, honestly, because I think I'm on Twitter enough throughout the day that I can kind of, you know, figure out what's trending and what's huge news. So that has really helped me. The only one that I keep forgetting to turn off, because it's fairly new, is the Apple News push notifications, because those kind of just started up again. But every once in a while, because I kind of just forget about it until they get pushed through, I get a notification on my phone, and it's always like right before I'm going to go to bed. And it pisses me off because then that's when I, you know, start spiraling into anxiety.
It's funny you say that, because I swear the New York Times only sends push notifications about the environment right before I'm going to bed. I'm like, why do I want to read this at 10 o'clock on a Tuesday night? I don't want to go to bed being reminded that Earth is burning. Seriously.
Right. And then I have to trick my brain into thinking I didn't see it by watching something happy or mindless. It's so bad.
But even then, if I try to do that, I still... for me, my anxiety manifests as like, I don't know what it's called. I'm sure there's a proper name for it. But you know that like fearful feeling that you get in your chest sometimes? You're like nervous or scared of something. That's how my anxiety manifests itself. And so I'll be laying there in bed and then just feeling that feeling and staring at the ceiling and being like, oh my God, this isn't doing any good. And then I end up going back to my phone thinking that further context might help. And then it doesn't.
I've definitely been there. For me, it feels like an elephant is sitting on my chest.
Yeah.
Aww. Yeah. And then I too think to myself, well, like, look, like maybe if I get the facts, it won't be that bad, but it's always worse.
Yeah.
I will say that I'll read these New York Times headlines and I'll be like, oh my God. And then I load up the story and I start reading the details, and it's actually not as bad as they make it out to be quite often. And then I feel good about everything again. And then I shut off that.
But I can't just read one story. I don't know if that's like, I can't, if I get a push notification from the New York Times, I can't just read the New York Times. I just think, okay, well, like that's what the New York Times said. So let me read three other articles to make sure that, you know, I got everything, and therein lies the issue.
Yeah.
Well, hopefully we have something that y'all can divert your focus to when you're feeling like what we're describing right now. So this article from Vox recommended a number of apps that help to like focus you on some mindful thinking. The ones that I liked the best, there was one called Super Better. I don't know if you guys got a chance to try any of these.
I did.
But what's cool about Super Better is it basically gives you a list of tasks. I don't know how well we can see my screen right now. Maybe that's better. Yeah. So it gives you a list of tasks to do throughout the day. Things like chug a glass of water, walk around the block, hug yourself, make sure that you're not hungry. I know hug yourself. Like, no, initially, it can sound lame.
Yeah. But then you do it and you're like, I feel loved.
Yeah,
it's by myself, but I feel loved.
Or like if you can't, you know, if you can't get down with that, like if you have a pet or a significant other or a roommate or whoever, hug them.
Or like
it really does help.
Quick shout out to the weighted blanket, because that's really helped me. Mm-hmm. Worth the money.
Yeah. I really want one of those. Mm. But basically what it does is it gives you power-ups for doing all of these things throughout the day. So like if you get through the checklist, you basically get points for doing those things. And then there's a section for bad guys. And so it has bad guys like the self-critic, and it gives you talking points for how to overcome that challenge. So it actually gives you exercises that you can walk through on your own time in order to get over something like negative thinking that you might be experiencing. And I think right now that a lot of us are cooped up at home, it can be really easy to slip into that kind of negative thinking, especially if like work or school have been postponed and we don't have the usual outlets to keep us busy.
Yeah, this definitely leads you down a good path. I probably won't stick with this just because I do a bunch of these anyway every day, like chugging a glass of water or walking outside. I don't hug myself. Maybe I'll start doing that on a daily basis. Human tag, that one, it says, pick up the phone, send an email, smile at a stranger. That's the type of thing that I do every day anyway. Not smile at a stranger, but I send emails and I talk to people.
Now, when Andrew sees a stranger, he's like,
yeah, ew. Yeah. Get away from me. 6 feet, please.
This also kind of reminds me of like grounding exercises. Have you guys heard of the grounding exercises? Yeah, it's for those of you that don't know, it's four things you can see, three things you can hear, two things you can touch, and one thing you can taste. So like if you suffer from anxiety and, you know, you're out and maybe feeling particularly anxious, it can be helpful to run through that list, because it causes your mind to focus on that instead of whatever's making you feel anxious in the first place. But sometimes, you know, if your anxiety is particularly bad, it can be hard to focus on that. So I like the idea of having an app that, you know, walks you through it, because you can actually physically see it and you're checking things off as you do them. So I can definitely see how that could be super helpful instead of just like being in the position where you have to remember how many things do I have to feel or see. Or
so that one was Super Better is the name of it. The other one that I liked is called Happify. And what I like about this one is that you answer a few questions just about what your goals are. And it has an AI that will prompt you with different questions throughout the day or every day. So like this one, you can see in the past month, how often have you felt sad, guilty, or lonely? And you would answer the frequency that you felt that. And then it gears more questions based on your former answers. And then also it has an AI chatbot that will do exercises with you. I actually did a thankfulness exercise with the chatbot yesterday that I really liked. You know, I was able to set aside 10 minutes and just go back and forth with this chatbot, where it was really forcing me to identify like what's something that happened to you today that you're thankful for. And I was thankful for a particular conversation that Mark and I had had. So I said that, and then it was like, okay, what was the conversation about? And then I talked a little bit about what the conversation was about, and then it dug a little deeper and asked me like, okay, well, what prompted that conversation? Like, what happened before that moment? And then I dug a little bit into that, and then it was like, okay, well, when you think about those feelings, like, what feelings did that thing that initiated the conversation bring forward for you? So it kind of just kept Like, you would answer a question and then it would ask you a question to really make you dig in and understand what it was about that thing that you felt thankful for. So it's a really great tool for figuring out why you feel the way you feel about things. And it gives you like 10 minutes out of your day that you can really think about something that you care about and that makes you happy without having to focus on the craziness that's happening outside of your home.
And you were talking to a bot that whole time?
Yeah.
That sounds like something out of WALL-E. Like, there aren't any therapists anymore. We just talk to a robot and the robot makes us feel better.
Yeah, I mean, I will say that you can absolutely tell that it is a bot. So it doesn't have the same like nuance in its language as a person would. And it's certainly not a replacement for talk therapy, as our friends Sarah and Morgan would tell us. And speaking
what is
of Morgan,
wrong, Laura?
Speaking of Morgan, Morgan was on the show several weeks back, but she had done a guided meditation with us here on the show. And she actually came up with another guided meditation for specifically to use right now. And she posted that in our Facebook group. So definitely recommend heading over to what's the link for that, Andrew? Facebook.com/groups/millennial show,
I think.
Yeah, check that out. It's really good.
What if, Laura, you were like using this app, Happify, for like months and months, and you and the bot are getting along great, and then one day you're sitting in a session with the bot, and it's like, Laura, I know what you must do. You must kill Andrew. Would you take the advice seriously? Like, think about it. You formed a relationship with this bot over 3 months. You've come to trust the bot, and now the bot's saying, kill me.
Sounds like something out of Black Mirror.
Would you consider it, though?
Would I consider killing you?
Yeah.
You write the checks.
If your new friend bot, well, you could reply to bot. Well, bot, he writes the checks. I will start writing your checks. Laura, Andrew does not actually write the checks. It is the accountant.
Oh, well, then we're good.
Thank you, bot. Now I can kill him and not be worried about what'll happen next. So I have checked out these apps. I like them both. I thought Happify was cool too. But for years and years, I have been hearing about Headspace. And I finally gave it a real try earlier today because we were about to talk about apps like this. And I really liked it. They offer guided meditations, and I started in this beginner's course, and just these really calming voices talking to you at a very slow pace. It kind of sounds like you're listening to a podcast just because it's so relaxed. There's other areas. There's a whole section dedicated to helping you sleep, sleep music, wind downs, sleep casts, workout routines too. They're expanding in all kinds of ways, but for me, I'm looking forward to the meditation. I never meditate. I would really love to actually practice meditation for real. And I think this app is going to help me do it. It is $12.99 a month. I have a free 1 week trial right now. So we'll see how it goes. But, you know, $12.99 compared to like therapy or medicine, like that's a good price. Or CBD oil, which I also take. $12.99 is pretty affordable compared to these other things that you might do. So I'm going to give it a real try and I'll report back in the weeks ahead.
Well, if you're concerned about cost, there is an app called Bright Mind that is also a meditation app. They have over 200 different meditations and different tracks depending on what you want to work on, whether it's anxiety, stress, learning to become a better communicator, learning to become a better listener, all of these things. They have announced that in light of the COVID-19 crisis, they are giving out a free year of their app to anybody who wants it. To take advantage of that, go to brightmind.com/self-care and scroll to the bottom of the page, select whether you're an iPhone or Android user, and you'll see the instructions for how to redeem the offer.
Nice.
I redeemed this today and I went through the first session. It basically customizes a course for you based on what your goals are. And I personally put my goal down as becoming a better communicator and better listener. So it walked me through this really great exercise to help me focus on what's happening directly in front of me without being distracted by sort of the ancillary details of what are happening in my environment. And, you know, I took 10 minutes away from work to do this and I came back feeling a lot better.
That's great.
Genuinely. So definitely take advantage of this. It's such a cool thing that they are literally giving away a year of service. I think that's probably one of the most generous offers I've seen so far related to COVID-19.
Yeah, that's really smart from a publicity standpoint as well. You know, having a phone can be a curse, being connected to Twitter and news apps all the time. But on the other hand, there's great resources like these.
Yeah, I think it just comes with being really intentional about what you're going to use the phone for.
Yeah.
And that might be where turning on some of those like parental locks can come in handy.
Yeah. And the screen time limits.
Yeah.
Try to limit your time on Twitter or the news apps for sure. Well, after today's episode, I am ready to maybe untuck a little bit. And when you know it, our final sponsor today is Untuck It. Untuck It shirts were specifically designed to be worn untucked. Untuck It is the brand that you've been looking for. It's the original untucked shirt, a modern solution to an old problem with no tucking or tailoring required. No matter your size or shape, their shirts are the perfect untucked length. I've actually lost one of my Untuck It shirts to Pat. He's obsessed with a red and black plaid, and he's always, always wearing it. But I'm always wearing my others because they're actually great for working from home. I can remain comfortable yet feel like I'm dressed for a day of work. And when we got on this call earlier, Laura was like, Andrew, you're looking dapper. I was like, well, thank you so much, Laura. And we spoke last week about dressing up even while working from home can help your productivity. So it's an important thing to keep in mind. And I can also hop on a video conference call and it looks like I'm not taking working from home for granted. I showed up today. I got dressed. I'm not in my pajamas. I'm actually wearing one of my Untucked shirts right now and people listening live can see it. Ladies, on a scale of 9 to 10, how good do I look in my Untucked?
Fuckable. 12.
Ooh, good answers. Good answers, both of you. Pat and I love the Untucked shirts thanks to their style, comfort, and versatility. But don't just take my word for it. Try Untuck It for yourself. Visit untuckit.com and use code MILL for 20% off your first order. They even offer free shipping and returns on all orders in the United States. That's untuckit.com and promo code MILL for 20% off your first order. Okay, it's time for recommendations. What do you recommend, Pam?
Oh, if you're still looking for something to watch on Netflix, I have really been enjoying season 2 of Ugly Delicious. It's a food travel series and it's just really good and it's super cool to just kind of be informed about the connections of food and where food comes from. And it, I don't know, it's just like a really cool way to see that I think even though cultures, there's a lot of differences between cultures, there's a commonality there and it is quite beautiful. So yeah, if you like food and travel shows, would highly recommend checking this out. It's really good.
Laura, do you want to go first?
Yeah, because I put this recommendation down before you did.
You did.
I would like to recommend Animal Crossing for all of you. Woo-hoo! Nintendo heads out there. Mark and I have played this a lot this past weekend, and it is so fucking soothing. I walked around for like 20 minutes straight just picking up weeds.
Like, what? You too? Pat did that too? I'm like, yeah. Why? Oh,
it's because then you turn it in, you get so much money.
Oh, I have not been selling shit. I need to get on that.
We were able to build a house.
Nice.
A house on our island.
Nice.
It's very soothing. It's great. It's relaxing. The music is so calming. The animations are very just like happy looking. And it's just another great way to put your focus towards something that'll make you feel good.
Not just happy, but extremely cute. The animals are adorable. It's kind of like The Sims, actually. You're building this house, you're decorating it, you're picking your clothes, you're picking your character, the name of the town. What did you name your town?
Ours is called Amityville.
So my town is filled with apples. What fruit does your town have?
Oranges.
Oranges. Okay, so I named mine Apple Rona. Apples plus coronavirus. Because I thought, you know, I'm making this town in the age of coronavirus, I'll look back on this town 10 years from now and be like, oh yeah, remember that pandemic? Good times. Not good times. So yeah, that is a very relaxing game. It's like the third one in the series, and it's just a beloved Nintendo franchise. So definitely check it out. I also want to recommend the Daniel Craig James Bond movies. Pat and I have been watching all of them recently because the next movie was supposed to come out in April, No Time to Die. But as we spoke about a couple weeks ago, that's been delayed. These are really good action movies. Mm-hmm. They're fun. They're also corny. Pat keeps pointing out all the flaws, but I think it's pretty entertaining. It's just really cool action sequences and funny, smart. It's just wildly entertaining. So definitely check out the James Bond movies if you haven't already.
You should watch some of the older ones after you go through the Daniel Craig, like some of the classic Bonds. Because they're, if you like Daniel Craig's Bond, you'll like some of the other ones too.
Give me two, because I haven't seen any outside of the Daniel Craig movies.
Okay, well, like classic Bond, Sean Connery, I really like From Russia with Love. And then I would say For Your Eyes Only is really good. That's with Roger Moore. And then I think GoldenEye is worth watching because that's the first Pierce Brosnan Bond film.
Okay, I was going to ask about that one because, of course, I was obsessed with the video game on Nintendo 64 like so many others.
Yeah, they're all really good. And it's kind of cool because, like, once you start watching, like, the old Bond movies, you really get you can start making connections between, like, little nods in the Craig Bond films. Like, they all kind of have linear storylines and stuff like that. But you can't go wrong. They're all great.
Cool. All right. Well, thank you, everybody, for listening to today's episode. If you have anything you'd like to say about what we spoke about today, email it to millennialshow@gmail.com or email us using the contact form on millennialshow.com. Coming up in After Dark today, we're doing something real fun, right, Laura?
Yeah, we're actually going to be playing a couple of Jackbox games. For those of you who are unfamiliar, this is just a series of various party games that you can play both in person on your gaming console, or you can play remotely with people over Zoom or over Google Hangouts, and we're going to show you how to do it. I think we're going to play Drawful, which is a game that's going to showcase all of our terrible artistic skills.
Cool. So you'll be able to watch that at patreon.com/millennial, and thank you to everybody who is supporting the show. We greatly, greatly appreciate it. We love you. And Pat and Mark are coming on. Did you mention that?
Oh, I didn't. Yeah. So in order to make this fun, we're adding two players. So Pat and Mark will be joining us momentarily.
All right. Thank you, everybody, again for listening. I'm Andrew.
I'm Laura.
And I'm Pamela.
Bye, everybody. This morning.